is completed. The airplane has been properly warmed up, prepared for flight, and is taxiing out to the takeoff area. On arriving at the head of the runway, the pilot stops the airplane and sets the parking brakes again. Press the pedals, lift the parking lever, and the brakes are on. And now comes the final check and engine run-up preparatory to takeoff. The co-pilot sets the throttles of all four engines evenly. At this speed, check the propellers for full range. Check first to full low RPM, high pitch. Press the switch bar to decrease revolutions, abbreviated DEC, and hold it until the limit lights all flash on. High pitch is used in normal flight because the airplane has forward motion and demands a heavier grip. Now the switches are changed. The switch bar is thrown to IMC for low pitch, high RPM, and held until the lights on the instrument panel flash on again. At high RPM, the engine develops rated power while the airplane is accelerating from a standstill. When the limit lights flash on again, the propellers are in full low pitch and the switch is released. Next item, the pilot adjusts the control tabs for best takeoff. Elevator tabs 1 degree tail heavy. Aileron tabs neutral. Rudder 2 degrees to 2.5 degrees right rudder to provide for engine torque. These settings are for normal conditions and loading. The pilot again checks the automatic flight control, or pilot, off. The controls for freedom of movement and the de-icer off. These checks should become automatic with experience because they affect the control and safety of the airplane. The co-pilot sets all of the mixture controls to auto-rich. Never take off in auto-lean, because the mixture is too lean for high power. Engines will overheat and detonation will result. Detonating engines have been known to stop completely and suddenly. Never attempt to use intermediate mixture positions. Check the fuel pressure with the booster pump off, 14 to 16 pounds. And then turn on the booster pumps for takeoff. The booster switches are the top row under the panel to the left of the co-pilot's control column. Again, check the engine head temperatures before run-up. They must be between 150 degrees and 205 degrees centigrade. The red line shows maximum temperature allowed in the air, but is too high for takeoff. Now we're ready to run up the engines. It is done one at a time, usually from right to left. Watch the tachometer and manifold pressure as throttle number 4 is opened slowly to 2000 RPM. Check mag switches right and left, with an allowable drop of 75 RPM on either. Now, open the throttle wide against the stop. Engine superchargers give about 36 to 37 inches manifold pressure at sea level. With throttle wide open, move the turbo supercharger control slowly to on. Manifold pressure increases from the engine supercharger boost to the final sea level takeoff setting of 49 inches at 2700 RPM. The turbo supercharger provides the added 12 inches boost. Now retard the throttle slowly again to 1000. Now on number 3 engine, open the throttle to 2000 RPM. Check the magnetos. Then, before opening the throttles wider, extend the wing flaps in order to take advantage of the hydraulic pump, which is only on this engine. To stop the flaps before full up or down, the operating lever is returned manually to neutral when the flap indicator reaches the position desired. The Fowler flaps are set to 10 degrees down for best average takeoff. This setting gives maximum performance in case of engine failure. 20 degrees extended flaps is the best setting for takeoff and gives maximum lift. For normal operation, however, the 10 degree setting is recommended. Now, open number 3 throttle wide to the stop. Open turbo supercharger slowly to the stop. The control is open slowly to permit the regulator to stabilize. Check the power instruments. They should read 49 inches at 2700 revolutions per minute. All engine control movements should be executed slowly to avoid abrupt power changes. Here, number 3 engine is kicking up the dust at full power output. Retire the throttle slowly again to 1000. Engine 2, open throttle to 2000 RPM. Check the magnetos, right and left. Open the throttle wide. Manifold pressure 37 inches. Open turbo supercharger slowly to the stop. Check the power instruments, which should read 49 inches manifold pressure at 2700 RPM. Number 2 blasts away. And now retire the throttle slowly to 1000 RPM. Engine 1, open the throttle to 2000 RPM. Check the magnetos, right and left. Open the throttle wide. Open the turbo supercharger slowly to the stop. Number 1 blasts away. All 4 engines have now been checked and are performing to the pilot's satisfaction. The throttle is retarded slowly back to 1000 RPM. After the turbo controls are set, they're left on and the throttles are set to maintain approximately 800 to 1000 RPM. This is slightly above normal idling speed, but prevents fouling of the plugs and keeps the turbo superchargers turning at a fair rate of speed. The left friction drag is tightened to hold the turbo control lever. Four generators are now cut in at the control panel, located outboard of the fuel gauges. The 4 switches are turned on one at a time. Generators are left off until after run-up because the excessive vibration on the ground adversely affects the voltage regulators. Now we gun each engine slightly to check the charge as its generator comes on. Number four, 50 amps. Note that the voltage rises as each generator comes in. This is normal. Number three, 50 amps. Number two, 50 amps at 28 volts. And number one, 50 amps at 28 volts. All generators are satisfactory. Close the cowl flaps to one-third open for takeoff. Open cowl flaps reduce speed about 8/10 of a mile per hour for each degree of opening. Furthermore, with cowl flaps more than one-third open, tail buffeting results below 150 miles an hour indicated. Again, move the landing gear lever to down, and on the hydraulic gauge above the pilot's control column, check kickout pressure at 825 to 875 pounds per square inch. Check the artificial horizon uncaged and also the directional gyro. Set the allometer for the barometric reading at the airport. Check that the nose wheel compartment is clear of the crew. Now we are set for the takeoff run. Press the brake pedals to release the parking lever, which drops down, and the brakes are released again. The pilot gets an okay from the tower and swings around into the wind heading down the runway. Then he opens the throttle slowly and evenly against the stops, where they are held by the co-pilot to keep them against any tendency of creeping closed. The throttle frictions are only lightly set for takeoff. Therefore, during the run, the co-pilot holds the throttles open and adjusts the turbo supercharger controls to equalize all manifold pressures at the 49-inch top limit. As the plane accelerates, the pilot applies a gentle back pressure on the controls to assist in lifting the plane on the gear. At 110 miles per hour, the plane with a moderate load easily leaves the ground. Hold the nose down and maintain the takeoff course until the indicated airspeed reaches 135 miles per hour. At this speed, full control is available in case of outboard engine failure. As soon as the airplane is well clear of the ground and definitely airborne, the landing gear is raised. If the landing gear fails to retract immediately, it is usually due to air in the system. To bleed it out, work the operating lever through up and down cycles until the action is normal. Usually, two or three cycles are sufficient. Lever up for a moment. Down. Up again. Down again. And now, here it goes all the way up. Now we retard the turbo control levers to reduce the manifold pressure to 45.5 inches, the maximum pressure allowable at the continuous power rate for 1 hour. With the propeller control switches, the co-pilot reduces revolutions to 2550, while the pilot readjusts the manifold pressure as the propeller pitch increases. After the landing gear lever has returned to neutral, the flaps may be raised at the pilot's discretion. Landing gear and flap control valves are operated only one at a time, never together. Do not exceed 155 miles per hour airspeed with the flaps extended. The fuel booster pumps are turned off, as their auxiliary pressure is not needed again until the fuel pressure drops 2 pounds due to altitude or until turned on again for a landing. Close the cowl flaps to a minimum opening required to maintain proper head temperatures. High airspeed cools better than open cowl flaps. Maximum head temperatures are 260 degrees in auto rich and 232 degrees in auto lean. Check the engine instruments. Oil pressure 75 to 90. Fuel pressure 14 to 16. Maximum oil temperature is 75 degrees centigrade in auto lean. In auto rich, for rated power 85 degrees and military power for 5 minutes 100 degrees are the maximum. The auxiliary hydraulic electric motor is turned off if other than a purely local flight is being made. Now we're assuming that the mission has been completed and that the airplane is returning to its base. As it circles the field, before entering the pattern, the pilot reduces speed to 155 miles per hour. He notifies the crew that the airplane is coming in for a landing and receives the report that the nose wheel compartment is clear of the crew. The hydraulic switch is turned on as the main hydraulic power will not be available when number 3 engine is throttled. The accumulator brake pressure is checked between 850 and 1125 pounds. Make sure that the automatic flight control or pilot is turned off. A landing would be difficult while attempting to overpower the automatic flight control. Cowl flaps are now closed to prevent rapid engine cooling in the glide, to eliminate tail buffeting as the speed is reduced, and to cut down head resistance in case the landing is refused. Mixture controls are placed in auto rich, the only position where full power is available. Intercooler shutters are open unless the carburetor is icing, but when used, watch the head temperatures. Turn on the booster pumps to ensure a positive flow of fuel to the engine pumps. The wing de-icers are turned off. Be sure to check this because the inflated shoes, when operating, become wing spoilers and change the landing characteristics. Move the landing gear lever to up to check the kickout pressure. This should be from 1050 to 1100 pounds. Then move the landing gear lever to the rear and downward to the down position. The lever will return to neutral when the gear is down. The landing gear lever may return prematurely due to surge, so it is necessary for a crew member to inspect all the latches. Each main landing gear latch can be seen from the rear window on each side. The top of the latch is painted a bright yellow to make identification easier and looks like this, unlatched. Unlatched and latched. The main landing gear latches cannot be seen with the flaps extended. Again, unlatched, latched. As the gear drops, the nose wheel comes down last because the main gear falls by gravity while the nose gear needs power. When engaged, the nose gear latch from the nose wheel compartment looks like this. Be sure it's properly engaged. Very sure, because it is important. After the landing gear lever has kicked back to neutral and the gear has been checked carefully and reported back to the pilot, with speed still at 155 miles per hour, we enter the landing lane. When in the groove, lower the wing flaps 20 degrees by moving the flap lever on the right of the pedestal to the rear. When the flap indicator reads 20 degrees, the control lever is returned manually to neutral. The half-down flap is recommended for the beginning of the approach, as the lift and drag are both increased at low speed, and the attitude of the airplane is changed for a wider range of vision during landing. Turbo controls are turned off normally. When landing at altitude, they are left in the position to furnish the required manifold pressure. Then handle the throttles carefully. A backfire may blow off the tailpipe. As you approach the boundary of the field now, place the flap lever in the down position. When the flaps are extended fully, the lever will return to neutral automatically and the indicator will show 40 degrees. Always allow sufficient time to settle into the new attitude before the final level off or flare. Move the landing gear lever to the down position again for final check and to ensure pressure in the line. Throw the propeller control switch to increase for high revolutions per minute, so that full power is available in case of a refused landing. As the airplane glides in for a landing, the throttles are retarded and the tabs are adjusted to maintain proper balance. To maintain a steady approach, a slight amount of power is usually necessary. Adjust the throttles as power is needed to keep the proper airspeed and position. Begin the flare with ample altitude for control response. Remember, this airplane has great momentum due to its weight and resists sudden changes of direction. The best landing attitude is the conventional one for airplanes not equipped with tricycle gear. Never land in an attitude which allows the nose wheel to make ground contact first. Now, as we pass the boundary and are in the landing position, the throttles are closed and held by the co-pilot to keep them from creeping open. Tabs are adjusted to lighten the control load. Now, over the runway, the pilot holds his airplane off, pulling the nose up for normal landing. This is the attitude for normal landing, with the airplane held off as long as possible. Notice how easily and smoothly the airplane touches the ground. As soon as the ship is definitely on the ground, the co-pilot places the mixture controls in auto lean. If the field is short and the brakes must be applied immediately, a three-point landing is permissible. When a three-point landing is made, it is done with the main wheels and the nose wheel touching the ground simultaneously. Notice again with the three-wheel landing how smoothly the plane makes contact and how moderately the brakes are applied after the nose wheel is firmly on the ground. On airplanes equipped with retractable tail skids, an emergency landing may be made tail down with the tail skid hitting the ground simultaneously with the main wheels. Here he comes now for a tail skid landing to show how high the nose of the plane may be maintained. By sending crew members aft after the plane makes contact, the tail skid may be kept on the ground for a long run, requiring no use of the brakes in a field of average length. After the plane has slowed to taxiing speed, the co-pilot should open the cowl flaps immediately to prevent overheating. Wing flaps should be raised before taxiing so that mud or rocks cannot be thrown into the overflap or tracks. When the flaps retract fully, the lever returns to neutral. Remember, turn and taxi slowly. Use the engines to steer. Don't use too much throttle. And keep the airplane well under control. The pilot here has perfect control as he taxis off the runway and turns to the parking area. Watch the use of the outboard engine. Upon arriving at the parking area, the engines are stopped. To do so, place the mixture controls in idle cutoff. 4, 3, 2, and 1. The throttles are opened as the engines stop. After the engines have stopped, the bomb doors are opened. Ignition switches, 4, 3, 2, and 1 are cut, and the master switch is turned off. Battery switch is off. Booster switches are turned off. AC power switch off. Generator switches are turned off. Auxiliary hydraulic pump off. and the wheel chocks are placed under the wheels. Now, center the service controls. Raise the control locking lever and secure it with the strap. Before leaving the airplane, the landing gear lever is placed in the down position. If the brakes are set while the drums are still hot, the internal brake mechanism will be damaged. Therefore, set the parking brakes only after the drums have cooled. Press the pedals and lift the lock. Cowl flaps are closed, but not until after the engine cools, because the heat retained within the engine will burn out the spark plug terminals. The B-24D is in its element when it's in the air. As we said earlier, it is highly maneuverable and has no vicious flying characteristics. It is a good airplane, and an airplane easy to control. Don't be afraid of it because of its size. Yet, at the same time, don't lose respect for it. Don't ever become careless or overconfident. But you can always remember this. The B-24D will get you there and bring you back. The rest is up to you.